like 6 lakh volunteers were taken in, and entire media flood was in Delhi as well as Bihar elections that did not help him. The same strategy that helped him in 2014 did not help him in 2016. Point number one. Point number two, Mayawati almost by definition, by rule, does not take even a single journalist on her campaign tours. She is not on social media. She does not give interviews to TV, Arnav, or anybody. She does not give interviews at all to press. And she got her own majority in 2012 without 2007 without handling all this media which was available at that time. So I think role of media is important but must not be overstated.
Just to add to that, I think it's a fair point that there's no real correlation perhaps between using the media to get ahead electorally. In fact, as I said, it could boomerang at times. But I think it's good for every politician and everyone in public life. It could be a politician, it could be even an actor, to engage with the people through media. I think it's good for their own image building. It's good for them to sort of demystify all the myths that are created around them and to debunk those kind of things that people think about them if they use these social media. So I personally feel it's good for anyone who's in public life to use various mediums at their disposal.
And you rightly said it's a question of your level of comfort with a particular media. I think, well, if the panelists want to...
Narendra Modi, I don't think over-engages with the media at all. I think he engages far too little. He thinks, he engages directly, it's all direct. I don't know how it's virtually possible to get him to do a televised interview with Narendra Modi. I mean, it's very, very difficult. He will not come into a conversation. He will only speak media. And so, it's not engaging with the media. I think he's presuming that he knows what people want to hear him say. And so I think it's a little different from sort of engaging with media, just to draw that distinction. He won't go to press conference. And the last interview was in London.
No, he doesn't give interviews. And he asked a couple of interviews that he gave to Avik Sarkar's team and others. He said, give me question answer. I mean, the questions you give me in advance. Then I'll decide which questions you'll ask.
I think so he doesn't engage in figures like prime ministers, sportsmen, actors, to allow a trained journalist at least to be able to sit and ask questions without a script. And it's getting more and more uncommon.
That's why he doesn't have a press officer.
I think credit to his communication style, because it's what he's done in terms of the schemes that he's announced. When you talk of Swachh Bharat, it's essentially UPA's rural sanitation program. When you talk of smart cities, it's essentially our national urban renewal mission. He said Aadhaar is a horrible scheme, I will never implement direct benefits transfer, Manrega, and today he's touting it as his own scheme. Digital India essentially is a continuation of our programs for rural connectivity and mobile tele-density. So he's good at packaging things. I'm not sure how long voters will sort of buy that and actually go deep into what you actually delivered on, and where you just put a wrapper around it. But that's time will only tell.
I'm sorry, I was supposed to make a long speech to you, and I have relieved myself of the task, and I think that this method of talking to you is much better than a long speech being made by me, which was the first item, and I deliberately gave it up. But now that we are in this style of functioning just now, I want to share with you a few thoughts, because they are also very reluctant to talk about Modi. I have confession to make that I am the first person who proposed that Modi should be the Prime Minister of India. But after he became the Prime Minister, I used to write my weekly piece in the Sunday Guardian, which I have done for the last 5 years. And I was the chairman of the board of Sunday Guardian. And I wrote my piece immediately after the election results. Dear Mr. Modi, congratulations on your spectacular success. And I am very happy that I have some small contribution to make to your success. But I am writing this today to tell you that so far as I am concerned, I am living in the departure lounge of God's airport. I want nothing from you, and nothing means nothing. now fulfill your promises to the people of India. I'm sure he read it. Since that day, he has never once even thanked me, visited me, or talked to me. So far as I am concerned, I have been watching the performance of his promises. And I wish to take the time which I have given up voluntarily only to share with you my experience. Throughout the election campaign, the main talk and the main item which attracted a lot of people was that he will bring back the black money which is stashed abroad and which a very, very responsible team had come to the conclusion that the money stashed abroad was $1,500 billion, which means about 90 lakh crores. And he went round in every election speech telling the audience that I will put 15 lakhs in the house of every poor man after I come back to power. I waited and waited. The German government, more keen to get at black money than Modi, paid $475 million bribe to an employee of the Liechtenstein Bank, and they got 1,400 names of illegal account holders having their accounts in the Liechtenstein Bank. The Swiss Bankers Association made an announcement that the majority of the names were those of Indians. Then the Germans made an announcement that we are willing to share this information with every friendly government which wants to have this information without cost and without conditions. What do you think should have been the conduct of every honest politician in this country? No politician in this country, either from the Congress party or from the BJP party, asked the Germans to give that information. It is because I found that the German offer was not being accepted even by the Modi government that I fought a case which I had started in 2009 in the Supreme Court, and I got the judgment only in 2011, in which the Supreme Court held that the Congress government had done nothing to recover this black money. They cannot be trusted to recover it. Therefore, the Supreme Court appointed a special investigation team presided over by two retired Supreme Court judges, Mr. Justice Shah and Mr. Justice Pasai. Well, nothing happened even thereafter. And I wrote an article, which I used to do every week in the Sunday Guardian. I wrote an article asking 20 questions from Mr. Finance Minister of Modi, Mr. Arun Jaitley. And my article always used to appear on Sunday morning. I used to hand it in on Friday evening. My friends, when I opened the paper of that Sunday, I found that my article, the whole space that was reserved for me, was occupied by an advertisement. My article had disappeared. I resigned the chairmanship of the board of the newspaper on that very day, put that article on my Twitter and on my social media, and of course on my Facebook. Then what happened was that I found out that my article had disappeared because of the conspiracy of those who did not want that article of mine to be published. That article asked 20 questions from the finance minister of Mr. Modi. And my friends, today, under the Supreme Court orders, they were asked to disclose to me the correspondence which they had with the German government. They did not obey that order for 2 years. Ultimately, in 2014, I was supplied the copies of those 17 letters which had been exchanged between the government of India and some German authority. When I saw those 70 letters which came to me, what has been blotted out from each of the 17 letters, the name of the author of the letter and the name of the addressee. In other words, those 17 letters were given to me, and believe you me, that I carried on my own investigation and I found very clearly that the two persons who were responsible were a girl by the name of Anita Kapoor, who is a well-known friend of Chidambaram, and the new person who has been appointed now as a CVC by the Modi government, that they have committed these forgeries and blotted out the names. I am going to soon ask for the prosecution of both Chidambaram and Mr. Arun Jaitley. On the other hand, my friends, to cut matters short, I was invited to Bihar by Nitish Bhai, who is a friend of mine. I respect him. But I went to him, I told him that, listen, I don't have much time and energy to campaign for you. I want you only to organize two meetings for me, and I will not take more than 20 minutes each. He did it. What did I tell the audience? I told the audience that though I am invited here to campaign for Nitish Bhai, I am not coming here to campaign. I have come for a different purpose which I will share with you just now. But so far as I am concerned, I wish to tell you that if I was a voter in Bihar, I would certainly vote for Nitish Bhai and nobody else. And my friends, after that, what happened was something which you will not believe, that I told the audience that I have not come for campaigning, but I have come here to offer my apologies to you and seek your forgiveness. With all my education and experience of politics, Modi made a fool of me. He cheated you and I helped him to cheat you. And please draw your own conclusions, but please give me the forgiveness, give me the maafi that I am asking for you, because I have my sin which I have committed. And you see what happened to Mr. Modi and the BJP party in Bihar. I can't see much difference between Mr. Rahul Gandhi's party and Sonia's party and the BJP party now. And therefore, today I am on my own, fighting the battle, and I have gone to Germany myself. And mind you, the Germans told me that there has been no demand from the government of India at any time that we should disclose to them the names of these officers. And you go back home and send us some two or three letters from the opposition party today, and we will certainly give you the information. I drafted a two-line letter for leaders of the BJP to sign. Nobody signed that letter because it is on the footing of that letter that names would have been disclosed. The common sense inference, my friends, is that there are criminals in both parties. Criminals in both parties who are being protected. This money has got to be recovered, and be sure that will one day be recovered. But it will not be recovered so long as you have corrupt people like Chidambaram and Mr. Arun Jaitley. And my friends, Arun Jaitley will have to go. I assure you he will have to go. But the question is of time. But I want all people in this country to raise your protest for God's sake. Those who claim to be intellectuals, don't go to sleep. Make a public demand that the Germans must be approached and approached officially. And I hope you will have at least the goodness to say that Mr. Ram Jethmalani should be put in charge of recovering this money.
I think this is interesting. Jethalani, you don't need a media trial.
Do we have time for to open up with the organizers? Would the organizers just come? Can we take a couple of questions from the audience? I have enough food for thought and imagination.
Means that the media is more powerful.
Can you just give your name and say which of the panelists you wish should answer your question?
I'm Udit Jain. This question is for you, Harish. Very well moderated. The topic was trial by media, which means that the media is powerful. What it's not saying is the judiciary is very weak. So my question is, why is the judiciary weak? Because in a competitive society, there'll always be competing agencies trying to exert themselves.
And let Amit take this question.
I don't think that's a fair observation to make and generalize that the judiciary is weak. There are, as a whole, if you ask me, I think the judiciary is very strong. The issue that really arises is that as you go up the ladder with your judicial training, you move into the High Court, you move into the Supreme Court, you find that judicial training actually comes to bear and you are able to be more objective and sift and keep the issues which come out in the media out of consideration in judicial determination. But it was recognized that the trials are conducted by the subordinate judiciary, which are at the level of the magistracy, the sessions court, which is the first rung effectively in this entire judicial process. They are young judges who are coming into the judiciary, and that is where you find some amount of impact. So as you go on with the judicial training, the impact is certainly less. Therefore, even when Anand earlier mentioned, and he thought, I think he misunderstood what I was trying to say, is that the media, the impact of the media is really at the pyramid of the judicial, base of the pyramid of the judicial structure. You will not see it as much in the High Court and the Supreme Court. I don't think that the judiciary can be described as a weak judiciary.
That is it. I must confess to you that our judges are also human, and there are some judges who are not as strong as they have to be. I will go further, that there are black sheep amongst them who probably are also corrupt. But my firm conviction is, which is unshakable, that compared to other departments of our public life and particularly our politicians, judges are still angels.
I can take two more questions.
My name is Zaid Bhanti, and my question is to Mr. Anand Goenka. It could also be answered by Mr. Kumar Kekar. On the point of stories being blacked out, there was another piece carried out in the caravan. Mr. Kumar Kekar spoke of the importance of the weeklies. There was this piece about this discussion on Times Now regarding Arun Jaitley's involvement in the DDCA scam. And as is customary before a debate, each panelist is asked to send their views to the editor, and he was called back and he was said, you cannot have such strong views, so you need to mellow down your views. He said that as much as my journalistic integrity permits me to, I will mellow down my views, but beyond the point I wouldn't be able to do that. He was told that an OB-RAN would be sent to his house. There was no OB-RAN at the end of the day. So he was removed from the panel because his views were not subscribing to maybe the moderator's view or the Times Now view. My question is to you, as someone who heads a journalistic enterprise, the Express Group, going forward, how can we ensure that such incidents do not happen and every opinion is out there in the public domain?
So obviously I can't comment on the Times Now incident, but and I'm not even quite sure who you're referring to when you said he wasn't, he didn't get the OB back to his house.
Mr. Hartosh Singh Bal, the editor of the Caravan magazine.
I think journalism is a tough job, and it's a big responsibility that everybody who gets into the profession signs up for. You know, with a lot of sort of questioning and a lot of social media, there's a lot more transparency than there ever was before. So I think, you know, if there are biases, they seem to come out in due time. And I think over time, you seem to at least figure out, you know, who are the really objective, credible sort of sources. What's happened, and look, there's no denying it, perception of news at one point was a far more noble profession. Media houses were far more noble sort of entities. Now, you know, paid news, trying to run after sort of social media. The perceived respect of news media definitely has diminished significantly, which is sad because I think that if anything, it's only become more professional and more transparent. Going forward, I think, you know, if you just ask the questions, you see that responses coming through. There's really no answer aside from saying that, you know, you've got to find the sources that you trust. There's a big distinction between, you know, a 100-year-old newspaper and maybe a blog that started 1 year ago, or, you know, a three-year-old news channel. You've got to find that distinction, and as consumers of news, we've got to become more discerning about sort of what we choose to consume.
But actually, your observation is quite right in the sense that journalists too often, and now it is more often than before, in fact, when they were not celebrities and when they were not paid so well, they had perhaps more integrity, though relationship is not direct necessarily. But the point is, it has happened, it is happening. One simple case in point is, Narendra Modi's wife has been denied passport. Denied passport, which is every citizen's right. And denied passport for what? Because she has not disclosed to the passport office in Gujarat marital status. So she has filed an RTI application that Narendra Modi is married to me, that will be mentioned in his particular affidavit. So that is the same certificate for me. That RTI story did not see much of the press. Some of the papers did publish, but that went inside the press, inside the pages. Imagine if the passport was denied to Robert Vadra, and the whole TV media would have gone to town. And here is Prime Minister's wife denied passport, the story did not make it. She gave an interview to a Gujarati paper saying that she feels insecure and unsafe in Baroda and Ahmedabad. That story did not make it to the national press or national television channels. Narendra Modi's wife, Prime Minister's wife. Now who blacks this out? Not the owners of the press. Not Goenkas and not James who blocked this. Who blocked this? It was the editors or news editors, whoever in charge, blocked the news when the news came. And I think that particular shortfall is today's journalism. Unfortunately, we should overcome it, we must overcome it. But otherwise, even media will be suspect in the eyes of the people.
Take one last question if there is.
I'm Prakriti Bhushan, and I would like to start by making a comment respected to Ramjeet Mohan. I had the opportunity of watching a debate in one of the houses of the parliament on YouTube, where you spoke about the black money being brought back to India. But due to constraint of time over there, and due to the behavior of rest of the people present in the house, they did not let you complete what you actually wanted to say. So I'm really lucky to listen to the whole thing that you actually spoke over here. And my question is, you spoke there in the House of Parliament, and the way people reacted to it, the committee turned out to be violent, the committee was totally against what you spoke. So just in 2 pointers, give me a way we can actually, the youth can work on bringing back the black money of what has been the big issue right now.
I have four methods of dealing with these kind of things, but I can't make everything public and give my enemies a handle to frustrate my desire and my plan.
The Would you take charge, please?
With that, we come to the end of the panel discussion for the evening. We must once again applaud all our panelists as well as our moderator. For a scintillating and thought-provoking discussion, I would now like to request Professor Dilip Shinde, Chairman of the Munkar Association at Government Law College, to kindly say a few words.
Good evening, distinguished panelists, dear students, ladies and gentlemen. It was the year 1978. I was a final year student in the Government Law College and a hostelite. We learned that Mr. Ram Jethmalani is going to argue a matter in the Bombay High Court. All hostelites rushed there to listen to him. And I distinctly remember the day, because that's the first time I saw Mr. Ram Jethmalani. When his matter was called out, he stood up. The chair next to him was vacant. He put his leg on the chair, his arms here, and he started his arguments with his booming voice. One did not require a mic even. It was loud and clear for all of us. Today, Mr. Jethmalani is 92 years old. He has completed 75 years of practice, and his energy and his booming voice is still there. And sir, we admire you. You have a lot of students who admire you and wish to be like you, and they're so happy that they were here to listen to you. And I'm quite sure that the main thing that you told us today, that democracy and freedom of speech go together and that we must fight for it. And yes, sir, I'm sure the youngsters of today will fight for freedom of speech and expression. Thank you very much. Mr. Devra, young, sophisticated, and totally non-controversial. He is to me an exception to the definition of today's politicians as given by Mr. Ram Jethmalani. Of course, he did say that more disruptive than the media are the Indian is Indian politics and politicians. It was wonderful to listen to you, sir. Mr. Kumar Kekar, editor of Maharashtra Times, editor of Lok Satta, a household name as far as Maharashtra and Maharashtrians are concerned, became a national name because of what is Times Now. He comes regularly on Times Now. And your statement that objectivity is a myth and everyone is biased to some extent, how true it is. And we appreciate what you stated about the freedom of the press as it is. Amitji, what the Nanavati case did for Mr. Ram Jethmalani, the Salman Khan's case has done to you. Yes, you have been a senior counsel, but amongst 100 other senior counsels. But because of one case today, you are the number one criminal lawyer in the Bombay High Court, and we applaud you for that. You also gave your personal experience in the Salman Khan case and his trial by media. It was very informative to us. Thank you very much. Mr. Goenka, as Mr. Jagtiani said, that he was a great admirer of Mr. Goenka, And during the emergency, Mr. Jadkani was a professor in Government Law College, and I have been one of his students. And like him, I was an admirer of Mr. Ramnath Goenka. And some of us hostelites went to meet Mr. Goenka during the emergency. And I must say that in spite of being a congressman, I was one of those who opposed the emergency. And Mr. Rajpurohit is here to vouch for that. We went there and met Mr. Goenka, and I appreciated, told him that when all the editors, all the owners of newspapers are purring like a cat, you are roaring like a lion, even during the emergency. And here, today, we have his grandson here. And he did a wonderful job in protecting the media amongst the various criticisms that were taking place. Thank you. Who is left? Yes. So that leaves us with our moderator for the day, Mr. Hare Jatiani. Mr. Jatiani, what a wonderful moderator you are. I believe that had you not joined the law profession, you would have been in place of Arnab Goswami. You have been a good moderator, a balanced moderator. I'm certain of. And thank you, all of you, for a wonderful evening. It was very thought-provoking, and we have learned a lot today. Thank you.
I now request Mr. Shanay Bafna, General Secretary of the Mukhbar Association of Government Law College, to give the vote of thanks.
The Government Law College, now in its 161st year, is an institution whose legal contribution and significance is unmatched. The D.M. Harish Memorial Government Law College International Moot Court Competition plays a pivotal role in reminding us all of the true caliber of this institution, of which Mr. D.M. Harish is a befitting example. The DMH panel discussion has always been the most electrifying aspect of the moot. It has been an absolute privilege to have Mr. Ram Jethmalani, Mr. Kumar Ketkar, Mr. Amit Desai, Mr. Anand Goenka, and Mr. Milind Devra. They have undoubtedly raised the stake and ensured that the discussion has lived up to its repute. I would like to thank Mr. Ram Jethmalani, Senior Advocate of the Supreme Court of India, for releasing the competition souvenir and for his invaluable contribution to today's discussion. I request Akansha Singh of the Moot Court Association to present Mr. Jethmalani with a small token of our appreciation. I extend my gratitude to Mr. Milind Devra, former Member of Parliament, for his prompt consent to be a part of today's program. I request Rajat Malu of the Moot Court Association to present Mr. Devra with a small token of our appreciation. I sincerely thank Mr. Amit Desai, Senior Advocate, Bombay High Court, for his enthusiasm and keen interest shown in this panel. I request Anmol Kaur of the Association to present Mr. Desai with a small token of our appreciation. I express my gratitude to Mr. Kumar Ketkar, Senior Journalist, for gracing this occasion with his exceptional knowledge and expertise on the subject at hand. I request Aditi Rastogi of the Moot Court Association to present Mr. Ketkar with a small token of our appreciation. I would like to render my appreciation to Mr. Anand Goenka, full-time director and head, New Media Express Group, for sparing his precious time and promptly consenting to be a part of today evening's function. I request Alap Anand Lal of the Association to present Mr. Goenka with a small token of our appreciation. I I sincerely thank our moderator for the evening, Mr. Haresh Jagtiani, for the invaluable support to various student activities at Government Law College and for so affluently moderating this evening's discussion. I request Raina Kalungo of the association to present Mr. Jagtiani with a small token of our appreciation. It gives me great pleasure to thank Mr. Adhiraj Harish for suggesting this brilliant topic for the panel discussion. A great round of applause for Mr. Adhiraj Harish. The success of BMH can be attributed first and foremost to the trustees of the DM Harish Foundation. They have stood by the association and the college for 17 editions of the competition, providing their support to the low and celebrating alongside during the rise. I request Snigdhani Roy Chaudhary of the association to present a token of appreciation to Mr. Anil Harish. I request Rupri Dhamija of the association to present a token of appreciation to Mrs. Shobha Jagtiani. I request Komali Shiyoshri Vastav of the association to present a token of our appreciation to Mrs. Hani Harish. I request Kunal Pradhan of the association to present a token of our appreciation to Mr. Sharan Jagtiani. I sincerely thank our principal, Judge Pramod Ambekar, for always supporting us in each and every one of our endeavors. I request Brinda Sharma of the Mukkar Association to present Principal Sir with a small token of our appreciation. The contribution and significance of Professor Dilip Shinde to the Mukkar Association is immeasurable. Year in, year out, Professor Shinde is our parent source of inspiration, care and guidance. I request Deepika Mukherjee of the Mukkar Association to present our chairman, Professor Shinde, with a small token of our appreciation. I would sincerely like to thank Professor Umesh Aswar and Professor Sonali Mathur, vice chairpersons of the Mukkar Association, for their constant support to the association. I would also like to thank Mr. Sanjay Kadam, the former chairman of the Mukkar Association, for building the committee to a great level till this day. I also thank all our eminent guests, professors and members of the legal fraternity for their august presence this evening. I would like to thank Ms. Ayushi Anandpara, Ms. Madhuri Doshi and Ms. Aishwarya Vaghe, former general secretary and assistant general secretary of the Mukkar Association, for their faith and moral support in all our endeavors. I have now come to truly understand and respect their undying dedication towards the association. I would also like to thank the members of the advisory board of the Mukkar Association, Ms. Persis Silva, Mr. Ruben Vakil, and Mr. Yuvraj Choksi for their support. I would also like to thank Mr. Rashnikant and Mr. Raj Purohit for gracing this occasion with their presence. I must also thank Niyati Mahindra, Saloni Mehta and Dwij Advaryu, senior members of the Mukkar Association, for their great commitment towards the association. Words cannot express my respect and appreciation for the former General Secretary of the Mukkar Association, Mr. Firoz Patel. His constant support and never-ending guidance has truly helped me as a General Secretary and helped this competition reach greater heights. The members of the Mukkar Association are very rightly the lifeline of the mood, without whom DMH would fail to materialize into the outstanding event that it is pegged at. I thank all our members for all the hard work, often groundwork, that they would voluntarily carry out. To the core committee, in my opinion, a thank you would not suffice. Having envisioned DMH 2016, together for over a year, I can proudly say that the final outcome deserves their special mention. Niyati Vakil, Shrey Sancheti, Nidhi Chokshi, Harshit Jaiswal, Alisha Shah, Shivangi Adani, Yuvraj Bhardwaj, Vaidehi Chande, Shaurya Jain, Danish Nethani and Arika Raina for their contribution, dedication and patience in making this competition a reality. I wish all the participants luck for the next 3 days, and I do hope that all the participating teams look forward to what has already begun of their EMH experience. Thank you.